Hello, my sweet friends. It is Sunday morning and it's May the 3rd. It's time for Sunday school. I still miss you guys so very much, but I am so thankful that God allowed us to be together through this technology. So we'll get started with our lesson today, but I want to start with a quick review of many things that we've talked about over the last few weeks. It's been a couple of months ago. We moved our Sunday school study from the Old Testament to the New Testament. Remember, the Bible is divided into those two parts, Old Testament and New Testament. And I want to show you this picture again. If you'll remember, we talked about how the Old Testament many years ago started with Adam and Eve, the very first people that God ever created. And we spent actually months and months talking about all the events that happened in the Old Testament. And some of those are pictured here, and they all brought us to Jesus. So there's a connection all the way from Adam to Jesus, our rescuer. And then the very next week, we talked about John being born, John the Baptist. We've spoken a lot about him the last couple of weeks. He was a forerunner of Jesus. And then we missed this lesson because it was the first day that church was canceled. But that was the lesson that day was going to be about Jesus being born. The New Testament starts with that. Jesus was born to be our rescuer. Jesus was dedicated in the temple. Do you remember this story of when Jesus was brought to the temple to be dedicated, which was the custom back then for babies? And there he was introduced to two people in the temple, Anna and Simeon, and they'd been looking for the Messiah, for the rescuer, and God was so gracious to let them see Jesus before they both died. They were old in age, if you'll remember that. And then we talked about Jesus as a child and how he went to the temple. And remember, he stayed there and his parents didn't know where he was and they were freaking out because where was Jesus? But he told them, "Mom and Dad, why are you worried about me? You should have known I would be in my Father's house," because he's God's son. He was in the temple spending time with the elders and the teachers and just spending time with God. And we learned about John the Baptist baptizing Jesus. That was an important story that shows us that we need to be obedient through baptism. And then came Easter Sunday. So we took a little bit of we veered off the path and went ahead and talked about Jesus's crucifixion and resurrection since it was Easter Sunday. After John baptized Jesus, immediately this happened. It was Jesus' temptation. Remember that Satan was trying to tempt Jesus. And we talked about Jesus experienced temptations just like we do, but he never sinned. And last week, we revisited John the Baptist again, and he pointed people to Jesus. And we talked about how we have that same job to point people to Jesus, although it may be in a different way than John the Baptist did. And that brings us to today. We are going to talk about Jesus and his early ministry, calling some followers to come and walk with him and learn from him. And they were called his disciples. So we're going to learn about Jesus calling those disciples, some of the stories of how he called the disciples today, and discover what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Let's open up in a word of prayer today as we get started learning about Jesus and his disciples. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for all of my friends who are watching today, and I pray that you would help them to be focused and to learn about you today and about how you called your disciples and how you're still calling disciples today to follow you and to carry out your ministry. I pray for all of us right now. Lord, we are missing each other, and I know my friends are missing seeing the other friends that we have at church. It's just a time where we can't be together, God. And so I pray that you would give us comfort in that. You tell us in your word that blessed are they that mourn or are sad, because you will give them comfort. So I ask for comfort today, and I ask for your help in teaching this lesson. And I thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that you have given us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
12 disciples Jesus called to help him, Simon, Peter, Andrew, James, his brother, John, Philip, Thomas, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon, Judas, and Bartholomew. He has called us to. We are his disciples. I am one in you. He has called us to. We are his disciples. We his work must do.
There were 12 disciples Jesus called to help him, Simon, Peter, Andrew, James, his brother, John, Philip, Thomas, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon, Judas, and Bartholomew. He has called us to. We are his disciples. I am one of you. He has called us to. We are his disciples. We his work must do.
Gentlemen, I hope that you are ready for another wonderful word from the wonderful Book of Words. Today's word is disciple. Before we talk about what today's word means, we will definitely want to talk about what today's word does not mean. It is absolutely, positively not a reference to a redneck reality TV star, as in this sentence. This guy pulled his sweet tea jug out of the refrigerator. That is very grammatically incorrect. Well, I don't like to admit it, but I guess I don't have any room to talk because I actually enjoy that show. Okay, anyway, let's get to our lesson. Okay, now that we have clarified that, let's talk about what the word disciple really means. The definition says, one who believes and accepts the teaching of another and helps to spread those teachings. In other words, a follower. We could use the word disciple in this sentence. Let's see. Jesus calls disciples to come and follow him and help spread the good news of salvation through him. Thank you for joining us on this segment of Wonderful Words. I'm tired. Oh, geez, I'm slouching. My mother would not appreciate this. Well, ta-ta for now.
I love that song that we heard just a minute ago about Jesus and his disciples. Songs always help me remember things. So if you want to watch that song several times, I am sure that you will be able to remember every one of the disciples. Did you catch how many disciples Jesus called? He called 12 disciples. And I'm going to read from the Beginner's Bible today about how Jesus called his disciples. And can you guess what books of the Bible these stories might be found about Jesus calling his disciples? We have learned that the Gospels, those first four books of the New Testament, are where we learn about Jesus' life. That's where his life is recorded. So these stories actually happen in the Gospels. Today we're focusing on the stories from Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So you can find these stories in those books of the Bible. But let's get started reading the Beginner's Bible. It says, Helpers and Friends. Jesus knew that he had a lot of work to do. He wanted to have some good friends who could help him. I like to have friends who are helpful too. One day, Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee. He saw two boats there. Peter and Andrew were fishing from one boat. James and John were mending a net in the other boat. Jesus called to them, "Come and follow me." I want you to remember that because we're going to talk about that phrase that Jesus used. Come and follow me. He actually told them, if you will follow me, I will teach you how to fish for men. We're going to talk about that today. And guess what? All those guys, Peter, Andrew, James, and John, all followed Christ. Later, Jesus passed by a tax office. There was a man there named Matthew. Matthew's job was to take the taxes, the money that people paid to the king. Jesus looked at Matthew. "Follow me," Jesus said. Matthew got up and followed Jesus. We're going to talk a little bit more about him in a minute. Jesus asked 12 men to be his helpers. Besides Peter, Andrew, James, John, and Matthew, he also called Philip, Bartholomew, Thomas, another man named James, so there were two James, Simon, Thaddeus, and Judas. Okay, friends, it is question bag time. We'll start out with a couple of easy ones. First question, what were Peter and Andrew doing when Jesus saw them? They were fishing, that's right. Second question, what was Matthew's job? If you said he was a tax collector, you are right. Here's our next question. It says, what does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus? Think about that one. Being a disciple means being his follower. If we follow Jesus and we are his friend, we are also his disciple. In Matthew chapter 4, Jesus says, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." What does that mean? Okay, so friends, I found the best fisherman I know to ask him, what does it mean to be a fisher of men? Take it away.
Well, to be a fisher of men, I compare it to the same thing it is to be a real fisherman, which is to, you have to have a fishing pole, you got to have fishing line, you got to have a hook, and you got to have bait. And that, in a lot of ways, is just like the Word of God. You have to have the Word of God, which is the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And you take that to people just like you would take it to a fish, and they will want that. They will want the good news of Jesus Christ.
Guys, I want to explore the story of Jesus calling Matthew to be his disciple just a little bit more. So watch this video.
Jesus was in Capernaum, and he was walking along when he saw a tax collector named Matthew sitting at his tax collector's booth. Tax collectors were hated by everyone because many people thought they were cheaters and sinners.
Oh, no one likes you. Let's get out of here.
But Jesus saw this man and said, "Follow me and be my disciple."
Me?
Yeah, you.
So Matthew got up, left everything, and followed him. Later, Matthew held a banquet in his home.
Hey, Jesus.
With Jesus as the guest of honor.
Jesus is here.
Oh, thank you.
Many of Matthew's fellow tax collectors and other guests also ate with them.
Ugh, yuck.
Hey, you!
But the Pharisees and their teachers of religious law complained to Jesus' disciples, "Why do you eat and drink with such scum?"
Hold on there.
When Jesus heard this, he told them, "Healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do." Then he added, "Now go on and learn the meaning of this scripture. I want you to show mercy, not offer sacrifices. For I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners. So Matthew went on to be one of Jesus's 12 disciples and followed him throughout his time on earth. He even wrote a book in the Bible about Jesus's time on earth, and he served God for the rest of his life.
Friends, we need to take a moment to talk about this story about Matthew because it is very important and very relevant for us today. Did you catch the part where Matthew threw this big party and there were a lot of people there who were sinners? They did bad stuff. Here's the secret. We're all sinners and we all do bad stuff. But anyway, there was this party and Jesus was there, and the Pharisees, who were like the religious leaders of that day, said, why is Jesus having this party with the sinners? And this is what Jesus told them. He said, people that are well, people that are healthy don't need to go to the doctor, but sick people do need to go to the doctor. What in the world did Jesus mean? Let's think about this. Sick people need a doctor. Jesus is kind of like a doctor for our sickness. And our sickness is S-I-N, sin. We all have a sin sickness. And Jesus is the doctor for us. He can fix our sin sickness. Now, here's the thing. The Pharisees didn't think they needed to be fixed. They thought they were perfect just the way they were. Lesson for us. Nobody's perfect. We're all sinners. The second thing I want to say is, if we are going to be fishers of men, people, children who need Jesus, we can't just do that at church. Because really, for the most part, the people at the church already know about Jesus. We need to be out in the world fishing for people, fishing and telling them about Jesus. Those are the lessons that I learned from Matthew. Okay, guys, in the spirit of fishers of men, which we've learned about today, we are going to play a game. And in this game, it's boys against girls at the Hicks house, except for me. I'm not playing. I'm the coach and the referee. And you, in our game, every person has three paper fish and one straw. In the game, they are going to have to suck the paper fish onto the straw without using their hands and drop the fish in the net. And this is a relay race. So in teams, we're going to see if the girls get their fish in first or if the boys get their fish in first. And the losers, of course, will be punished because that's what we do. And let's get started.
Are you ready for your fishy challenge?
Yeah.
On your mark. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Get set. Go. Oh, everybody's got one in.
No, Arnold.
Oh, no, Bethany does not.
Okay.
Shelby, you got two in? Oh, Shelby got all her fish in.
Yes.
Jack needs.
Come on, Bethany.
One more. Chad's got all
her
Guys, I want to remind you of what we built last week with our Legos. I hope you were able to do that. We learned John 3:30. It's a very important memory verse. And it says, "He must increase, but I must decrease." John 3:30. Remember, the he we're talking about is Jesus. Jesus is so much more important than we are. And we need to get rid of our selfish stuff and make him the king of our life, make him so important. And I'm just thinking about how this verse relates to those 12 disciples. They had a decision to make. They were either going to follow Jesus, and that means that he was going to increase and they were going to decrease, or they were going to make themselves more important. We have that same choice today, and it's really a choice that we make every day. What are we going to make most important in our life? Is it what we want, or is it what Jesus wants? Jesus is asking us to follow him. And often that means when we follow him, we have to let go of what we want and do what he wants. But friends, I just want to tell you, even though those things are hard sometimes, you will never, ever, ever regret or be sorry that you followed Jesus. Take my word for it. If we make him increase and if we decrease, great things are going to happen for us.
Okay, friends, punishment time. Cold water coming your way, boys. Ready?
Gotta heat up,
set,
gotta heat up.
Go!
Oh, man! Oh, golly! That's so...
All right. He got on me, man!